We can stop the ring. Welcome to Decent Life. I'm Lou Pugliafito. The call-in number is 212-245-7273. 212-245-7273. The guidelines for calling in are is to listen to your phone and not watch the show, because if you're watching the show, I'll be trying to talk to you and I'll be hanging up and you'll be calling back. Also, lower the volume on your TV or computer because we don't want any feedback while we are talking. And also, if you like, your first name and the location where you're calling from. And we're continuing our series of having members of the city council, you know, candidates to come on the show and discuss the issues with us. And tonight we have Christopher Marte. Chris, welcome to the show tonight.
Thank you for having me.
No problem. Chris is a candidate for New York City Council District 1. And basically, Chris, two things. Why did you want to get into this? And also tell us a little background, because you said that you mentioned that you grew up here on the Lower East Side. So if you'd just like to fill us in a little bit.
Yeah, I'll start with my bio and then why I'm running. I was born and raised in the Lower East Side. My parents immigrated here from the Dominican Republic. My dad was a bodega owner, and my mom was a sweatshop worker out in Williamsburg. So growing up, when I wasn't stacking cans in my dad's bodega, I went to our local public school, PS20. So I did get that New York City public school education, and I feel like that's what gave me the opportunity to sit in front of you today.
All right.
For college, I was fortunate enough to study abroad. I studied in China for 2 years, Latin America, and in England, and then I shifted to work in the public, private, and not-for-profit sectors.
That's interesting. So can you, I'm not sure what part of Asia Margaret Chin comes from, but can you talk in Chinese to her, or her dialect?
Not her dialect, but I speak a little bit of Mandarin. And it's interesting because in our district, it's mostly Cantonese speakers because they came from the Canton region.
Mm-hmm.
However, some of the newer immigrants are from mainland China, so they speak Mandarin.
All right, because a lot of people don't realize that China is a big country and Asia is a big country, and there's different dialects that go to it.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's interesting that you study abroad, and you came back here, and you're on the Lower East Side.
Yeah.
And so what inspired you to say, you know what? This is it. I want to put my hat in the ring, as they say, throw my hat in the ring. What is it about New York City, the United States, or District 1 in general that has made you?
So my path started almost 2 years ago. I was a volunteer basketball coach at one of the most underfunded schools in Chinatown, and seeing how these kids barely had basketball jerseys and we barely could use the gymnasium in their school made me feel depressed and sad. Mm-hmm. And then seeing our elected official, Sheldon Silver, take millions of dollars from our community that could have gone to these after-school programs or youth programs made me want to change how things were done in Lower Manhattan. So I actually ran for state committee last year, which is a volunteer position, and I did it with no political support and no financial support, but I was able to make waves. I got more than 2,000 votes and lost by 2%.
Right. So is that different than being on a community board, being the committee that you're on, or is that
the same? So the state committee is within the Democratic Party. So it's kind of like the structure is before, you know, your state assembly, you have your state committeemen, and then you have district leaders.
Okay, and you know what, I was looking at the map, if you just give me a second to cue it up, is that it's interesting about District 1. And how it encompasses not just Lower East Side, but it looks like the Brooklyn waterfront.
Yeah.
And is that Governor's Island? And
it is Governor's Island, Ellis Island, and it covers not only the Lower East Side, but Greenwich Village, all the way down to Battery Park City, through South Street, Seaport, Chinatown, and parts of the Lower East Side.
All right. So it's very interesting that you would have the harbor, Brooklyn Harbor, there per se.
Yeah.
So, from this, is that what is specific in District 1 that you want to see? Because I saw on your website that it's transparency is the number one concern of yours.
Yeah. So transparency and community engagement. We haven't had a town hall meeting in 8 years in our district, and I think that's a huge concern. When you look at small issues, whether it's sanitation to bigger issues like overdevelopment or waterfront resiliency, many community members don't even have a voice. And so when you don't have a voice or you don't have a seat in the table, how can you be a true representative?
Okay, are you talking like participatory budgeting, or is that something?
Yeah, and that's part of it. You know, it's participatory budgeting. It's a process which allows the community to vote up to $1 to $2 million of my budget to be allocated within the community. So whether a playground needs repair, an air conditioner at a public school needs to be fixed, it allows to have a more democratic, community-based platform.
All right, so that's $1 to $2 million per district?
Yes.
Okay, that's not too bad. And what I'm seeing here is something about the Rivington houses and the property deeds, and that's how you were getting into transparency?
Yeah.
So what exactly happened down, because I'm not sure if all of our viewers know, about the Rivington houses. I'm pronouncing that right?
Rivington house, yeah.
And what exactly transpired that get everybody upset?
So the Rivington house personally affected me. I grew up across the street from it. Originally, it was a public school. Then it became an AIDS hospice. And then it became a senior nursing facility center.
All right.
And pretty much overnight, the deed restriction was lifted, and it was sold to luxury development without any say of the community. And, you know, there was rumors for years that this might happen, and people contacted our local elected officials, and they did nothing. And now we have public land that used to be part of the community set aside for now. It's going to be luxury condos. And you see this repeated throughout our district, whether it's in the Two Bridges neighborhood or in Tribeca or in the West Village, where we have our public space, or we have people who live in low-income housing pretty much being displaced, and luxury massive towers coming to replace them.
Okay, so do you feel that Margaret Chin was part of that, or was it the de Blasio that was the problem, that they did this by the cloak of darkness, or whatever you want to call it?
You know, there are some allegations out there, but I think it's, at the very core, is mismanagement. You know, as a city council person, you should be able to manage everything that's happening in your district. And you should know whether a zoning policy is expiring or if a community facility is being let go and transferred over hands. And I think just letting that slide.
Okay, we'll get that back to the guy. I don't like to have callers wait too long.
Okay, all right, sounds good.
Okay. Hello, you're on Decent Life. You have a question?
Hi. So I had a question about waterfront resiliency. So the whole, with all of the new developments going up, how does it affect like the community in terms of waterfront resiliency? Do they hinder or do they help out with building a better?
Excuse me? You dropped out.
Oh, sorry about that. I dropped out.
You said up to waterfront and?
So with waterfront resiliency, there's a lot of new developments going up, but there's still no plan in place. So do these new developments, will they help progress the plan for waterfront resiliency, or do they hinder it?
Well, I think they hinder it because there isn't a plan in place. And when we take the Two Bridges neighborhood specifically, when Sandy hit, that whole neighborhood was flooded. And to build 90 stories, massive luxury towers there, I feel it was a concern to the residents that are going to move in and the residents that live there right now. And I think we need a city council person that's not going to not only fight against that, but actually mobilize communities from the Lower East Side to Tribeca to say, we need a plan in place because we don't know when the next hurricane is going to come.
Okay, and when she's talking about waterfront resiliency, that's mm-hmm. with the Sandy and so when the next emergency comes.
Yes.
And also, because of all this waterfront development, and you have the Brooklyn, is there a lot of, closed-door meetings that we need to get into, or?
I don't think it's, I personally feel like a lot of these meetings aren't happening.
Oh, they're not happening at all.
Or not happening where the community or community boards have an active say in it. You know, a lot of the members of community boards and a lot of the residents felt it firsthand. And they want to know that or be updated at least to what's happening. And I think that's what a city council person should do. Be transparent, update the residents, and tell the residents you're actually doing some work.
Okay, so basically, Margaret Chin just basically went about her business and said nothing all the time. Is that what you're saying? Because I read something about her and Gail Brewer did some type of legislation for deed restrictions. Do you think that was enough, or was it a Johnny Come Lately thing, or what about that?
It's a reactionary. You know, it's not being proactive. The legislation came into play after the Rivington house was sold. You know, we saw similar legislation with expiring zoning policy. You know, after zoning was expired in the Two Bridges neighborhood, she decided to put legislation to notify her the next time a zoning is going to expire.
I hear you. So, in some way, a fact is what's going on in the who should be responsible for what's going on doesn't know what's going on.
Yeah.
And you want to change, you want to go in and do that. So let's say you get notified of all these things going on, and these real estate developers, they're really salivating to get on this waterfront property and really do all this stuff. And like you said, with two bridges, is that, how do we stop that? How do you, is there a way to stop this, or?
And so there is. Okay. There's this plan that was created by the community. It's called the Chinatown Working Group Plan. It's been out there for almost 8 years. And more than 80 community organizations came together and said, we need to protect our neighborhood, Lower East Side and Chinatown. However, our city council person never fully implemented it or supported it. This would put height restrictions on any new development. So now we see the Excel Tower potentially going to be 90 stories. If the Chinatown Working Group Plan was implemented in its entirety, that will be closer to 30. And so you just see the difference if you take proactive zoning.
And would there be like income factors for people who live there, like say low or middle income to move in, or is it just strictly, you know, market rent? Or I'm not sure, is it a condo, is it sales? Or
so XL Tower is mostly luxury condos, which is sad because the Two Bridges neighborhood, it's a working immigrant family community. I was talking to a resident.
Just to go back to the television, what is the Two Bridges neighborhood for people who are?
So it's the southern part, southern east part of the Lower East Side. So right off the Manhattan Bridge. So you could take it from Cherry to Water, and then it goes down to Catherine Slip.
I gotcha. But they call it Two Bridges. Is there another bridge involved, like Williamsburg?
Yeah, so it's between the Williamsburg and the Manhattan Bridge.
Oh, so all that they want to develop into luxury.
Well, currently it's being planned for just the area right next to the Manhattan Bridge.
All right. And so just, you know, take a little piece at a time, as they say.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I see throughout the discussions I had with the people who are running for city councilors, everybody's saying, no, we have to attack housing, have to attack housing in a way that doesn't push everybody out into Pennsylvania and upstate. So do you think this China Working Group would do that, would keep middle-income and low-income families in the neighborhood, or?
Yeah.
All right.
I think it will, you know, and I think it's taking every opportunity, whether it's the Chinatown Working Group plan or another zoning policy, to make sure that it remains affordable, because there is secondhand displacement. You know, when luxury towers like XL are coming into a neighborhood, maybe your rent doesn't go up, but every service that you purchase in that community goes up. Whether it's a, you know, gallon of milk at your local bodega, or
your bodega goes out of business.
Exactly.
Because they can't afford the rents that are coming up the way, and people can't afford. Yeah, I understand that. There's multiple factors going on. But there's anything in specific in the China Working Group that you think is the number one issue that we should be working on in here?
I think it's height restriction.
And
also within the plan, it advocates for tenants' rights, which is one of the biggest issues that we see now, where landlords do see profit in communities, communities of low-income families, and they try to, you know, create tenant harassment situations to get them out, and so they could make their apartment be market rate.
You know, I'm from the Upper East Side, and I think that might have been one of the first gentrified areas.
Yeah.
And I don't know what they did doing today, but they used to send people around with baseball bats. We're talking about late 60s or early 70s.
Yeah.
So it was something. Yeah, but so what do you think that with the transparency?
Yeah.
So we're looking at, you want to get everybody involved. Mm-hmm. We have the working group. So what do you think after that we need to, is there something in the education that we need to do, or is it community policing, or is house crime in the area? Is crime on the rise, or how do you feel the overall environment down there is? Is it getting worse? Is it getting better? And how do we stop it if it's getting worse?
Yeah, in District 1, it's extremely diverse community. You know, you have Tribeca, you have Lower East Side, you have Chinatown. So crime fluctuates per neighborhood, per year, like what time of the year. However, it's education. You know, if people know that there's a zoning policy that was built by the community to protect the community, you know, we'll have a stronger push to advocate for that. And with education as well, in schoolings, you know, our neighborhood has lack of seats in schools, and we're one of the fastest growing communities in the city.
Okay, so lack of seats meaning that you have more of a children population than you have seats in school.
Yeah, because if you just look at the financial district, so many new families are moving in. And in the Lower East Side, you have the construction of Essex Street Crossing, where it's going to bring 5,000 units live to our community. And we don't have the infrastructure in place to support that.
Okay, so basically, let's build up the area, but they're not really giving it a thought to how to do it, and that's where the China Working Group is.
It's part of it because the district is wider, but specifically for Chinatown Lower East Side, I fully support this plan.
Okay. Do you think there's some things where we could address the speculation in the real estate market? No, it's not just the District 1, but it's everywhere.
Yeah.
That the I think it's common knowledge, at least it's my feeling that I don't have any proof that it's really investment. People coming to see, you know, New York City is a good place to put your money.
Yeah,
you know, and that's driving up all this luxury highways. All this money coming. Is there any way you think we could stop that? Stop that restriction? Is it a way to maybe tax something?
So that's mostly a state issue, but I will be fully supportive of taxing non-New Yorkers who buy real estate property in New York.
Okay.
And because that actually brings money back to the city and helps us improve our infrastructure.
Right, because as you see, is right. I understand that the taxes for New York City, it has to be approved in Albany.
Yeah.
But we need somehow to say, hey, look, we need to get a handle on this Wild West, per se, thing. Because it's amazing what's going on. And what I feel is that if more people move out, who's going to support the tax base? Who are they going to tax if the middle class is not here anymore?
Yeah. And, you know, not only that, but working and middle class families, they're the backbone of the city. You know, they're your teachers, they're your janitors, they're your firefighters, they're your police officers. And when you don't have them, if you have them commuting 2 hours a day, they might not work here. They might not be here anymore.
So do you think that we need to... I'm in rent stabilization. I'm not moving out.
You're living the good life, the decent life. You're living the decent life.
Yeah, I'm not going until they carry me out.
Yeah.
You know, but basically, are you looking to, you know, prop up like rent stabilization, was it Section 8 or the New York City Housing Authority? Are there a number of projects as per se in the local District 1?
I think one of the greatest initiatives that have been taking place by a few individuals in my district is finding a legal conversion of rent stabilized, rent regulated apartments that have been converted to market rate. And once we find those out and take them to the courtroom and bring them back, we'll see a new pool of affordable units without constructing another massive tower.
Okay. So, you know, we talked about a lot about housing and transparency. Is this something that I haven't touched upon that you know that you really want to get going once you're elected?
Yeah, and I think the next is campaign finance reform. You know, when we talk about...
Well, hold that thought. We have someone else on. Hello, you're on Decent Life.
Hi. My name is Eun Lee, and I'm a small business owner in Manhattan, and I have some concerns about all the empty storefronts that have been on, you know, every newspaper from the New York Times to everything else. I feel like the our elected officials are talking about potentially fees for landlords who keep storefronts empty, but I feel like there's no movement. There doesn't seem to be enough, balls on the part of politicians to really make move things to protect small businesses and also fine big landlords and small landlords for keeping their storefronts empty for years, months and years. So it's something that's a concern of mine.
Okay, so thank you for the call, and thank you to previous caller for your call as well. So small businesses, as we discussed, the press is going on, so what do you think what we should do with the small business?
So there's actually a piece of legislation that's on the floor of the city council called the Small Business Survival Job Act, and this allows small business owners to have a fighting chance to renegotiate their lease with the help of the city. Okay. And not just for 1 or 2 years, because as a small business owner, you can't really make a projections for that. But this is for 5 years and 10 years. And I think having a coalition of city council members to push that through will make a huge difference throughout the city. In my district, you see small business closing from Greenwich Village to Chinatown.
Right. Yeah. So how about, like, I think she touched upon a vacancy tax?
Yeah.
To tax... landlords that have empty storefronts?
Yeah.
You think that's a good position? Is that something that Albany has to do or something we could do here locally?
I think both. I'm fully supportive of a vacancy tax, because once a small business dies, I feel like a community starts dying. You know, you get less foot traffic. People stop going to that community. And I feel like, I tell people, once you see one vacant storefront, it's almost a death sentence for every other storefront in that neighborhood.
It's a domino effect.
Exactly. And so I'll be fully supportive of a vacancy tax, because they're just warehousing storefronts and is making sure that if we have something available, we should make sure that we're using it to the fullest.
Okay. And in that Jobs Act that you just said, is that there's a way for the city help to renegotiate instead of the small business owner negotiating on their own.
Yeah.
So somehow they could get the data and support they need to do that. But there's nothing else for me to say that, hey, we're still not going to rent it to you, because ultimately the landlord has the right just right now to say.
It's mostly regarding a lease renewal. Oh,
okay.
So it gives a small business owner who's been there for years, maybe decades, an opportunity to renegotiate their lease so they can stay in the community that they helped build.
And you said that part of the bill's name was Job Act?
Yeah.
What's the job part of
it? Because when a small business closes, jobs are no longer in that community.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah. I thought maybe that was going towards a minimum wage and maybe like your $15 an hour. Man. So that's what comes to mind with me when we talk about jobs in the small businesses and so on, is that about minimum wages and so on like that.
Yeah.
All right. So, you know, we're coming up to the end. We talked...
Okay.
We covered a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
And I just want to make sure that is there anything in closing that you would like to tell our viewers and the people watching that down at District 1?
Yeah. Well, thank you for having me.
That's no problem. Hopefully we'll have you back on for the general election. You know, have a little
bit exactly.
All right. So,
but I think especially now with what's happening on a national level, where every day we're getting Twitter updates or opening up a newspaper and we're seeing something dangerous and disgusting happening, I think we have to focus on local politics and having new energy and someone that stands up for what we consider progressive ideals. Mm. Whether it's universal health care, universal education, we need local elected officials that draw the line there. And I will be that person. You know, I have a track record of community engagement in my neighborhood.
Yeah.
I have a track record of fighting for people who've been disenfranchised. And I think that's the energy, that's the understanding and the expertise we need in the council.
You know what? From all the people, the candidates out there, are really inspired to do this and to make change. And, you know, there is an old, I don't know how old the saying is, but to think globally but act locally.
Yeah.
And that's basically, that's the only way we really can make change. We can't start up here.
Yeah.
We have to, together, create a wave.
Yeah.
You know, and then hopefully that wave will grow and grow and grow and sweep across, and hopefully it'll sweep across the middle states as well.
Exactly.
And then, we'll have a better life. But I think, all in all, is that I think this inspired all of us, what has happened with the presidency and so on, is that, you know, when we all had enough. And so let's do what's right. Let's get out there and and do something about it. What I thought was interesting, though, is since we have another minute, there's a group that you had on your site, Run for Something.
Yeah.
Can you just explain to our viewers what the Run for Something is?
So Run for Something is pretty much just doing exactly that, getting young, energetic, progressive leaders to run for office. I've been fully endorsed by the organization Run for Something because they believe that I carry that message and that vision. So hopefully on September 12th, you can vote for me and we can keep that message alive.
And I do too, because you know, Chris, with people like you, candlelights like you, we can stop the rain, and all we need is love. Thanks again for being on the show.
Thank you so much.
So long, everybody.